I have a privilege to host today one of the outstanding persons in the United Nations community. I suppose that he's number one in the topic you are acquainted with, the right to reply. Those who are in that issue deeply understands how controversive the issue is, how important it is. And we are going to listen Dr. Ivan Simonovic. Luckily, he is from academic, and still he never disconnected his ties with universities. He's the doctor on law. He is today with us as Assistant Secretary General and advisor to the Secretary General on the responsibility to protect. Well, I all of you invite to, well, to listen and then to raise the questions, whatever you are interested in human rights broader, in human rights more narrow, in the specific issue. You are acquainted with the biography of Dr. Ivan Simonovic. He has outstanding career in the United Nations and in home, in the European Union. All the recent years he dedicated to the human rights protection in very difficult circumstances, surroundings, and so on. I witnessed how he pushed the human rights issue to be on the agenda of the Security Council. Security Council of the United Nations doesn't like to deal with the human rights issues, pushing them outside to Geneva or somewhere. But today you will hear from our guest how the things are interconnected. Of course, United Nations is about three pillars: peace, development, and human rights. But sometimes it's very important to remind people and member states about this interconnectedness. So I don't want to take your time and your. Let's start. Floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Yuriy, for your kind words, and I enjoy being with you here, colleagues. And I do envisage this as an interactive session. So I have my bullets on the paper, so do not hesitate to intervene if you would like to comment something. You do not have to wait to the end. I won't get lost. I'll be able to continue. And in fact, I'll enjoy if you do it, because I'll see that you are participating in this. To start immediately with participatory character of this session, I will offer you, in fact, two menus, and you will be choosing. I was preparing for two lectures I need to deliver on the same issue. One is more historical, trying to position development of human rights and responsibility to protect in last couple of decades. And the other one is more hands-on. What does practically in the work of the United Nations responsibility to protect mean? So the choice is yours. Which one would you prefer to have served this evening?
Well, don't provoke us. Well,
I see they are not asking the floor, they want second one. Yeah, so the hands-on one, okay. I will not lose too much time explaining what human rights are. I will just mention that the origin of the concept of human rights are in our deep past, in the ancient Greece. The idea was first reflected by Stoic philosophers as well as sophists. And at the time, we can consider human rights as a philosophical idea. An idea that all people are born equal, and as equal they are entitled to some rights. Somewhere around 16th century, this philosophical idea is transformed into a political demand, a demand for various aspects of what we call now human rights. So we can see it early on related to Magna Carta Libertatum. We can see that in French Revolution, Liberté, Fraternité, Égalité. And today, especially after the Second World War, human rights have been transformed into legal entitlements. What I would comment very briefly on human rights is that they are universal, meaning that everyone is entitled to her or his human rights just by the fact of being born as a human being. You don't have to deserve your human rights. You are entitled to them by being a human being. They are universal, meaning that all over the world they should be respected. They are interconnected and they are interrelated. So civil and political rights, as well as social and economic and cultural rights, are mutually interconnected. What would civil rights, for example, mean? For example, to be free from torture, political right to vote or to be elected on political functions, social and economic rights, for example, in sense of social and economic rights, we can speak about right to water and sanitation, we can speak about right to work, and so on. Now, let us move to a less known concept of responsibility to protect. Responsibility to protect is not currently a legal, an international legal obligation. However, it's an important political commitment that may one day transform into a legal obligation. Something similar has happened with human rights as a philosophical idea, as a political demand, which at a later stage after the Second World War has transformed into legally binding obligations under international law. Now, as is currently, the concept of responsibility to protect has been defined in the outcome document of the World Conference in 2005, held in New York, in its paragraphs 138 and 139. Basically, it says that every state has an obligation towards its own citizens to protect them from, and then it's listed, to be protected from genocide, to be protected from crimes against humanity, from war crimes, and from ethnic cleansing. If state is not capable of protecting its own citizens or other subjects that are currently on its territory, then its obligation of other states to help to respective state to protect from mass atrocities on its own territory. So the whole idea is that you give primary responsibility for protection from mass atrocities to sovereign state. However, if state cannot exercise such a sovereign responsibility, other member states have responsibility to help to the respective state. How to help it? For example, through financial assistance, technical assistance. But it also goes further. In situation where state manifestly fails to protect a population on its territory, and they are under serious threat or subject to mass atrocities, meaning, again, those four categories that we mentioned, genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and ethnic cleansing, then other member states have to take a swift and decisive action in accordance with the Charter of the United Nations and with the approval of the Security Council to protect a population from, again, those four crimes. Out of that emerged a doctrine of three pillars of responsibility to protect. That doctrine has been established through yearly Secretary General's reports on responsibility to protect. The first pillar is that each and every member state has the original obligation to protect population on its territory from genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and ethnic cleansing. Second pillar, if state is unable, then it's obligation of other member states to help to the respective states in its protective role. But in situations where perhaps even a member state itself is involved in crimes against humanity, against its own population, or genocide against specific group, it's obligation of other member states to use, if necessary, other means to protect that population. What can be those other means? They can be coercive means, meaning it could be sanctions, but it could also imply, as a last resource, the use of force. However, provisions of 138 and 139 points of the outcome document make it clear that it has to be done in accordance with the UN Charter and after the approval of the Security Council. Now, what is the relationship between human rights and responsibility to protect? Responsibility to protect covers only, as we mentioned, genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and ethnic cleansing. It doesn't cover other violations of human rights. So human rights are much broader than this concept of responsibility to protect. However, what is practically very important, especially important from the perspective of prevention, mass atrocities, genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and ethnic cleansing do not come out of blue. They do not come suddenly. They usually come after periods of various human rights violations, and some human rights violations are specifically characteristic as early warning sign of potential incoming mass atrocity. So if we have, for example, a certain group of population systematically discriminated, if it's subject to structural discrimination, if it's subject to various forms of harassment, we are seeing a very dangerous pattern that from our experience indicates a likelihood, that indicates risk of potentially coming mass atrocities. So in a way, some human rights violations that are characteristic as early warning sign serve as canary in a mine. You may know that in old times the miners were carrying with them canaries in the mine, because it was first canaries that, because of poisonous gases, would collapse, and then you would go out and you would save your neck. So when we see human rights collapsing, let us not wait for the mass atrocities. This is a red alert that if something is not done, we are on a dangerous path. Now, this is the underpinning idea of human rights up front Secretary General's action plan. That action plan has been developed just a couple of years ago, so it's a work in progress. Its essence is that we should early on identify characteristic patterns of human rights violations, and that early warning signs should be followed by an early action to prevent atrocities from occurring. It's a Secretary General's action plan, meaning that it is mobilizing Secretariat and not member states to do what United Nations system can do by itself to prevent the threat of mass atrocities. How do we practically do? We have something that we call human rights quarterly reviews, human rights upfront quarterly reviews. We have divided member states into a couple of groupings based on the region where they are located. And various parts of the United Nations systems are having regional quarterly reviews where we are having an insight into situation and trends in respective countries. Of course that we do not spend the same amount of time to countries which are more or less going all right and to countries where we have some disturbing signs. So disproportionate amount of time is devoted to country situations which are observed as threatening and as deteriorating. If during quarterly reviews it's identified that it's a threatening situation with imminent threat of mass atrocities, they are brought to the attention of senior action group. Senior action group consists of a group of UN principals, so heads of various departments of the United Nations, Department of Peacekeeping Operations, of Political Affairs, Human Rights Office, United Nations Development Program, and a couple of others. And it's chaired by Deputy Secretary General. And the whole idea of Senior Action Group is that after analysis provided by quarterly review, this is a place where UN discusses what practical actions can be taken immediately to diffuse the tension and to try to help to prevent further deterioration. What will be the immediate effects? The immediate effects will be that the UN field presence in a country where situation is deteriorating is being strengthened. How strengthened? Probably some political advisors or human rights advisors will be immediately deployed to help and assist resident coordinator in the country. Because you have to understand that when you select resident coordinator during peaceful times, you are selecting a person who is a good expert for dealing, for example, with cooperation, technical assistance, developmental issue. It's not necessarily a firefighter. And in deteriorating situation, you may need a firefighter. So you will either support current resident coordinator with some additional advisors that will be helping, or you will simply, without any shaming of resident coordinator, replace resident coordinator with somebody who has experience with red hot situations. There will be also some other actions taken to ensure that there is a joint action by the United Nations system in headquarters, that we do not have different messages coming from different departments in New York to the field, and that there is a unified UN response to the crisis. But that's not all. UN is looking into who is best positioned to help in the situation as it is, to help to prevent further deterioration of situations. And sometimes it will be heads of states, current or previous, of neighboring countries who have some specific leverage in that country. It could be some regional organization. it could be some major donor countries. So it's not always that United Nations will act only by its own officials to prevent this crisis, but will use its convening power to try to use all international deterrent factors to prevent a situation from deteriorating. Now, let us stop being theoretical and see, for example, what are currently situations that are obviously deteriorating and that are threats in sense of mass atrocities. Obviously, what comes first to our minds is a situation that we are seeing in Aleppo, situation that we are seeing in Mosul, situation that we are seeing in South Sudan, where fighting is being reignited again and is undertaking quite an ethnic-centered hostilities and animosities. We can see such a deterioration in Burundi, where now human rights observers from the Human Rights Office have been restrained in their movement and access to victims, where we have a situation that international commissions of inquiry has been have been barred from coming to the country. Some members of commissions of inquiry have been proclaimed personae non grata, and where current Secretary General's political representative has been labeled as undesirable, and there is a request to replace him with somebody else, where the same pressure exerted to the UN is exerted also to African Union representatives, including their observers. They are being harassed, protested against, where protesters are coming in a very organized way, brought to protests by government lorries and obviously state-sponsored. Now, these are practical examples. In some situations, it can be immediately reacted with some preventive value, in some not. For example, look at Aleppo. It's a bloodbath. We are every day receiving reliable evidence on killings of civilians, of deliberately starving parts of the city, and those parts of the city are also inhabited by civilian populations. We have evidence of indiscriminatory attacks. Today, over 20 children have died in a single attack. How many out of them died because of lack of medicines? We, for the first time, have serious evidence of cases of malnutrition, severe malnutrition among civilian population. Or the threat that we are seeing in Mosul. It's like the ancient tragedy. Ancient tragedy starts, ancient Greek tragedy starts with the chorus announcing that tragedy will happen. And then events are leading to this tragedy. We all know that it's a tragedy in making, and we can't do anything to stop it. We know that if in Mosul you have Shia militias coming in, that it will be a bloodbath, that there will be a retaliation against Sunni civilian population, because Sunni civilian population, at least part of it, was having some understanding for ISIL. Why were they having some understanding for ISIL? Because previously Sunni population was discriminated after the fall of Saddam by Shia. So it's all very much interrelated. And in some such cases where we have Security Council deeply divided, there is relatively little that can be done, which doesn't mean that we should not be pushing, that we should not be naming and shaming actors, be they world or regional powers who play negative role. But in practical sense, there is relatively little that we can do. But there are some situations when, if we intervened timely, something very practical can be done. I'll address something from my own experience. I was in Côte d'Ivoire during the crisis and fighting. If I may remind you, it was a situation where President Gbagbo did not want to acknowledge the results of elections, where President Ouattara has been elected. And UN was having its peacekeeping mission on the ground, but it also had an unusual mandate to confirm the results of the elections. And we have confirmed that Ouattara has won the elections. However, Gbagbo was using armed force to prevent Ouattara from taking on. And in fact, pro-Ouattara forces were located in the north of country, and Ouattara himself was in Abidjan, in the south of the country, surrounded by pro-Gbagbo troops. And in fact, United Nations were using peacekeepers to protect President Ouattara in Golf Hotel. And at the time, of course, there was a high threat also for our UN peacekeepers. We also had some casualties. So we reduced number of UN personnel to a bare minimum. And that's the time when I'm coming to Abidjan, to Côte d'Ivoire, to help the mission to cope with challenges. And so far we had a situation that only troops that were affiliated, or militias that were affiliated to President Gbagbo, have been involved in war crimes, crimes against humanity, tortures, rapes of political opponents. And then troops supporting President-elect Ouattara started to move from the north of country, going towards Abidjan, and to use, with the help of Burkina Faso, to help to install President Ouattara. And the situation is further complicated, that President Ouattara is representative of Muslim population, Gbagbo of Catholic population. There are some also ethnic divisions between Northerners and Southerners. So it's a potentially very sensitive situation. And for the first time, we are seeing that pro-Ouattara forces have also been involved in war crimes, including crimes against civilians. And I'm hearing an information from our Moroccan battalion there that in Dwekwe, pro-Ouattara forces have committed a massacre. So I'm going there, and I was able to see bodies of massacred civilian population. And I'm returning to Abidjan, and I'm going to Golf Hotel to talk to President Ouattara. What I was carrying him was one page, a photocopy of the article of the Rome Statute dealing with command responsibility, emphasizing that civil as well as military leaders are responsible not only for commands they give to commit war crimes, but also for not preventing them or not punishing them. And I thought just, I was very upset after seeing what happened in Dwekwe. I thought it's going to be a short and possibly unpleasant conversation. But it lasted for hours, because President Ouattara was highly interested to hear What was the practice of ICTY? What was the practice of Tribunal for Rwanda and other international or hybrid tribunals when applying command responsibility? The same day, President Ouattara appears at a national television saying, all crimes, no matter whether committed by forces under my command or control or by forces under President Gbagbo's, former President Gbagbo's command and control, if they commit any crimes, they will be held accountable, and I promise they will be punished. So what does that say? It was the right momentum. It was a window of opportunity where the president-elect Ouattara was on the brink. If he didn't choose that path, if he didn't announce that there will be punishment of his own troops if they commit war crimes, it might have been much bloodier. In spite of that, also President Ouattara's troops were involved in some atrocities. However, when you see criminal proceedings before International Criminal Court, because Cote d'Ivoire was at the time and still is a member state that has ratified Rome Statute, so far it was only people involved in war crimes on President Gbagbo's side who were prosecuted by ICC. And I think that this experience can be generalized, that the crucial moment when you exercise your responsibility to protect, when you can do something to prevent mass atrocities, is before political and military leaders reach the point of no return. When you have reached the point of no return, as is a case, for example, in South Sudan now, with involvement of top leaders in two horrible crimes for many years, in which they cannot say that they were not aware of, they were aware of, they didn't prevent it, they didn't punish it, then leverage is relatively small. Because they know that once they put down their arms, what they can expect is accountability and prosecution. However, if we approach political and military leaders when there is a dangerous trend, but they haven't yet reached the point of no return, we can influence their behavior. Now, let me assess current situation globally. We have had, from the perspective of human rights and responsibility to protect, we had very progressive development after the end of the Cold War and after the fall of Berlin Wall. We had at least 15 years of consistent progress in the human rights area and in the area of international humanitarian law. I think that things started to change somewhere between 2005-2008. And if I would have to assess trends now, and we can, during the discussion, discuss what may have been reasons why things went wrong, trends are now negative. The number of conflicts in the world in the last years is increasing. So it's something that you can quantify. It's not my impression, those are facts. Number of killed in conflicts are increasing. For example, in 2015, we had about 200,000 people killed, which is almost a 30% of increase when compared to 2014, which was higher than 2013. When we speak about international humanitarian law, it's a nice word, humanitarian, it's in fact law of war, defining mass atrocities. we are having a continuing lack of respect. We can speak about total disregard of international humanitarian law. Civilians are being deliberately targeted. For example, we were speaking of South Sudan. In South Sudan, to quite an extent, hostilities were conducted that parties to the conflict were killing civilians on the other side, rather than confronting militarily with military units. So you were fighting by killing civilians of other political affiliation, but also of other ethnicity. We always had in history, we always had some rogue actors that were involved in widespread violations of IHL. But now, this is not an exception. This is becoming a habit. This is becoming a way that hostilities are being conducted. And when I'm talking to law students, I feel quite embarrassed to raise the issue of international customary humanitarian law, because it's not a custom anymore. Respect of international law is not being a custom of the warfare. Sometimes it's not deliberate targeting of civilians. Sometimes it's, as we have seen in Yemen, as we have seen in many other places, we have attacks that may be targeted on military targets, but totally disrespecting what happens to civilians. We call them unselective, unproportional, because use of force is unproportional to the target, military target that you are trying to reach, and they are unselective because you are using as targets, for example, civilian populated areas in order to target some military units. As a result of those conflicts, as a result of the way that hostilities are being conducted, we are having highest number of refugees and displaced persons, so we can all call them together forcefully displaced persons, than ever after the Second World War. Currently, we have 65 million forcefully displaced persons. And again, if you would draw a curve from year to year, it's not exponential, but it's growing very fast. In the same time, the rate of return is lowest in last 15 years. What that means? It means that we do not know how to prevent conflicts. We do not know how to prevent mass atrocities. And we do not know, or we are unsuccessful in helping to end conflicts and helping to people to return to their homes in safety and dignity. In the same time, we have a problem of migrations, which are not forced, but are caused by some other very understandable reasons. You know, we have somehow made quite an arbitrary distinction between refugees, and we agree more or less that refugees are to be protected, and migrants. For example, due to climate change, you can have whole islands which will be swallowed by the sea. If those people go out of those islands and they seek refuge elsewhere, they're not refugees, because they are not prosecuted for their political beliefs. They are just migrants, and they have not been attacked. Well, they would be attacked by sharks, but it doesn't count. This, as well as situations such as, for example, in Eritrea, where people are subjected also to compulsory lifelong military service and various human rights violations, You should take into account also situations where equally important as human rights violations, which are creating you a legitimate refugee, a legally accepted refugee, and people who are fleeing away of starvation, which with the climate change we shall be seeing in Sahel more and more often. So we need to handle all those movements of population. And at the same time, we have a fear in Australia, in the United States, in Europe, fear of waves of refugees and migrants. We have a spread of xenophobia. We also speaking about dangerous trends. In recent years, we have increased pressures against human rights defenders. Again, it's not just an impression. There are some systems to register how many human rights defenders have been, for example, killed. Their number is growing. We have an increasing number of journalists that are being harassed. And some empirical researches, such as Freedom House research on democracy, is indicating that since 2005, democracy index is not growing, but is falling down. So, let me conclude with a bit of optimism. We shall have soon new Secretary General on 1st of January. He is inheriting a very troubled world, but I think we know the direction he has to take, and it's prioritizing prevention. We have invested last couple of decades huge amounts of resources for humanitarian assistance, for even more, for heavy peacekeeping operations with many soldiers involved, with many hard equipment, and it's extremely expensive. The shift that needs to take place is shift towards prevention. And I think that current Secretary General, with human rights up front, has established a good start for such a strategic shift. However, it will require major changes. It certainly does require change in culture. It requires change in institutions. It requires changes in prioritizing of distribution of financial resources. More resources should be devoted to prevention. And that prevention should be treated very broadly. Yuriy mentioned that the United Nations are based on three pillars, and it's development, peace and security, and human rights. And it was Kofi Annan who once said, there is no development without security. There is no peace and security without development. And there is neither without human rights. So investment in human rights will be essential. If we do not provide basic human rights in countries where people are massively emigrating from, if we do not help them with the establishment of reliable justice system, protection of civil and political as well as social and economic rights, we won't be able to control migrations. We will be also having conflicts, which will then bring new waves of refugees to our borders. So I think that investments in prevention are not only a very human approach, but they are also in the self-interest of the developing countries. So, thank you very much, and I stand ready not only for questions, but for your contribution, your discussions, and your comments.
Yeah. Thank you, Ivan, for such a comprehensive picture of your activity and what is going on broadly. And so now I open the floor to the audience. Please name yourself, as Ivan invited you, well, to not only to put questions, but to share something. Well, okay, I will not limit anybody.
Yeah, and you don't have to agree with me.
Mm-hmm. We'll see.
Yes, Bernhard Witt, Political Science Department. How do you think the election of Donald Trump will affect what you've said?
I think it's a part of it. If I would observe political trends, I would say that there are some similarities in the developed and in developing countries. In both of those categories of countries, we have two elements. I would say we have a real, genuine fear in population. Fear of changes, fear of dynamics of change, fear of diversity. And we have deep dissatisfaction with elites that are perceived as corrupted. If we ask ourselves, again, nothing comes out of blue. Where does Islamic radicalism come from? It comes from perception that some states, some even states that are Islamic states, have corrupted leadership, that they do not follow the God's will. In the same time, there is a fear for the essence of their religion, of their way of life, related to globalization, related to Western influences. So if you combine the two, you are seeing root causes of Al-Qaeda's, root causes of ISIS, root causes of Boko Haram, root causes of Al-Shabaab. Also, we should not estimate that when we speak about some radical movements, again, quite often, they also are based on reaction to some forms of discrimination. I have personally talked to the radicalized fighters who were fighting for Al-Shabaab or Boko Haram. And I know that majority of them come from similar or even the same ethnic groups, that they come from ethnic groups that they were discriminated against. I'm not running away from Trump. I'll get to Trump. But I want to explain that in the interconnected world, it all comes together. What we are seeing in the West is, again, a similar sort of fear. Fear of diversity, of changing our own ways of life, of changing character of our societies, with all those people coming in. And quite often, it's in France, it's in Austria, and we are having elections on Sunday. We are having that in Poland, we are having that in Czech Republic, we are having that in Hungary. So it's not just a coincidence. There are some structural reasons. Dissatisfaction with political elites and fear that is caused by globalization. So something quite similar is at present stage in the United States, I would say. Also, the fear of Islamic radicalism, the fear of immigrants, the fear of jobs going out of United States under the influence of globalization have heavily influenced political choices of the American people. What I firmly believe that at the moment it seems that it's irresolvable vicious cycle in developing countries, in developed countries. I believe that the way out of it is not disrespecting human rights of refugees, disrespecting human rights of the ones who are different from the majority of population, but that the way out is really better respect of human rights. And speaking of responsibility to protect, I think that a lot can be done through prevention. I think that preventions from troubles that we are having in developed countries cannot be to build walls or to put barbed wire, but to try to help to societies that are emanating emigration or emanating refugees to resolve the reasons why people are fleeing away and why they are hopeless. Does it cost? Yes. But current situation, I'm deeply convinced, costs more.
Ivan, Professor Hechtved teaches interesting course, European Fascism.
Well, I think it's currently very interesting.
Yeah. Well, please.
Thank you for being here. And, you know, I don't want to get into the influence of Russia on European politics and how that affects human rights, but I'd like to focus my question on Turkey. And it seems to me, I run a nonprofit here and I have a lot of people on the ground in Turkey, and there seems to be a lot of human rights violations regarding refugees, both within the camps and on the streets. And my people, people I know with whom I work, tell me that UNHCR has perhaps the most access to refugee camps and detention centers as of any other human rights organization, because a lot of them are barred. And it appears that there are many unfortunate, inhumane events and conditions going on within the camps that UNHCR is tolerating or is not publicizing. And I understand the politics, but I don't understand why UNHCR has not been more active in at least diplomatically talking about not only the refugee situation in Turkey, but the political situation, the arrests, the detentions, the closing down of media outlets, etc. I don't hear anything from UNHCR about it. And if you are publicizing or talking about it, it's not reaching the media. So I'd like to know, number one, what you're doing, and number two, if you're not doing enough, why are you not doing enough? Is it just political expediency or what?
It's not only UNHCR, it's not United Nations, it's international community at large that is not holding Turkish authorities to account for what they are currently doing. I agree with you. What is going on in Turkey under the pretext of fight against the violent coup is in fact a prosecution of any sort of political opponents, but I mean peaceful political opponents, or even further, anyone who has an independent thinking, such as you mentioned, a number of intellectuals, media outlets. So why is that being tolerated? I had opportunity to discuss these issues with some top EU officials of the European Union as well as national officials. And when talking in private, what they are saying, listen, we need Turkey to keep refugees from coming to our borders. It's not only because we are ruthless and we are interested in getting votes for resolving the refugee crisis. It's also because we are afraid if we do not do it, a professor who deals with fascism in Europe will have a lot of business. We are afraid that far right is gathering strength out of those refugees that are coming. So it's between rock and a hard place, so we shall tolerate Turkey's wrongdoing, taking into account a broader picture. This is what I'm hearing, and I think it's very wrong. I think what may happen with Turkey, unfortunately, is that I could not exclude if in Turkey those dangerous signals that we are seeing with in the same time very heavy-handedness against Kurds as well as heavy-handedness against secularists, against opposition, we could see a civil war in Turkey. And if you have a civil war in Turkey, you won't get only 2 million refugees from Turkey, but you will get a couple of tens of millions of Turks being on your borders. So I think it's a short-sighted thing. So I am concerned, if you ask me, about the situation in Turkey, both with regard to the military operations in southeast against Kurds, which we do not hear much about. At the time, now I am not, as it says here, Assistant UN Secretary for Human Rights, now I'm for Responsibility to Protect. But until 1st of October this year, I was Assistant Secretary General for Human Rights, so I still feel quite comfortable under under this title. We were trying to go to southeast Turkey. We were not allowed in. So, you know, when you have repressed civil society and media who cannot report on what's going, you can't get there. It's rather difficult to get accurate information so that you can really speak up against violations. But the trend is dangerous, and we must look into most appropriate ways to address publicly and speak up of violations that are taking place in Turkey, including some related to camps. Although, in sense of physical infrastructure, camps in Turkey are quite good in sense of physical infrastructure. They are very much restrained, and in some respect they are similar to prisons because people cannot go out. But otherwise, in sense of infrastructure, what I have seen in some other countries, camps in Turkey are relatively decent.
But if I may follow up one point, the UN is different from a government in terms of a Western EU government, and I understand they have to be concerned about the potential resumption of refugee inflow into their countries, into the EU, from Turkey. But the UN is supranational, and it seems to me you can, or the UN can, can publicize, can talk more openly about violations in Turkey than, let's say, Germany or any other country in Europe. And I don't see the UN, or UNHCR, whatever body of the UN you want to talk about, saying anything. I hear silence, and I don't understand why.
Let me give you practical examples to understand better what is going on. You may recollect that Saudi Arabia has been put on a list of countries. There is a list that Secretary General produces on a yearly basis. That are committing violations against children, either by recruiting them in their armed forces or by, for example, unselective shelling. So Saudi Arabia was put on that list, and the reaction was a dramatic one, announcing that Saudi Arabia will stop all its contributions, including humanitarian contributions, which is pretty drastic. Interestingly, Ban Ki-moon, probably thinking along the same lines as you did, went public and said, you know, Saudi Arabia is threatening that they will withdraw. So he did temporarily suspend putting Saudi Arabia on the list, not to lose funding, but he went public. And, well, what happened? Saudi Arabia said, oh, we never really meant that. And so I do think we need to be bold. But what does it mean in reality? I won't mention names of the state, but when I was ASG for human rights, I had not only permanent representatives of two member states, but the high officials who requested from Secretary General not to extend my contract because I was speaking up. So it has some very practical consequences. And Secretary Generals also are selected in a way that requires support of 15 members of the Security Council and consensus of P5. Is that good that we function that way? No, it's not good, but that's reality we live in.
Simon, I'm in political science and also the director of the Genocide Studies program here. I've actually got several questions, but I'll only ask one unless there's a lull. The one question I think I'll ask is about, because it follows on that last point, Security Council reform. It strikes me that one of the hindrances to implementing a robust version of responsibility to protect is that there is always that doing nothing is just a veto away. There's been a lot of talk of Security Council reform, maybe reaching a crescendo a few years ago. Is that dead in the water at this point? And even if so, what would you do to make the Security Council more responsive to responsibility to protect?
First, let me be pessimistic, and then I'll try to climb up towards some optimism. I think that United Nations have been born with a genetic defect. And its genetic defect is provision of the charter, that to change charter, you need a consent of two-thirds of member states and consent of P5, of permanent five members of the Security Council. Mission impossible. So I think that your students would be shocked to find out that still in charter we have provisions dealing with enemy states. We still have in the charter references to enemy states, meaning Japan and Germany. Currently, now, in 2017. What does that mean? It means that we have created an organization that is, at least in its basic normative document, in its constitution, unable to change to reflect changes in its environment. Am I therefore optimistic that there will be some serious changes where Security Council members, P5, will voluntarily give up their prerogatives? I don't see that coming. Even in most drastic situation, that so-called French-Mexican initiative, that at least P5 should voluntarily accept that they will not use veto power in situations of atrocity crimes prevention. Even on that one, we do not have a consensus. So I do think that perhaps pressure by academia, pressure by civil society, if picked up by media, if picked up by population at large with social network, can exert pressure to P5 and their political leadership. But is it going to be enough? Is it going to be timely, or shall we once again wait for too long, as we did with the League of Nations? Now, what I can be a little bit more optimistic about. When I came to the United Nations, and it was in 2010, the doors of the Security Council were almost completely closed to information dealing with human rights violations, very relevant for the top world body dealing with peace and security, because either those human rights violations are early warnings of incoming mass atrocities, or they are pattern of armed hostilities, and you have to know that it's a pattern when you are deciding on the mandates of the United Nations troops, whether you will be mandating them to protect civilians. If you mandate them to protect civilians, you should equip them adequately, you should give them arms, you should give them shield, you should give them helicopters. You should not give them just protection mandate and then leave them out in cold. At 2010, when I look from the moment that Human Rights Office have been established, and it's in 1994 and 2010, we were given opportunity to brief Security Council less than once a year. And we ended up in 2016 briefing Security Council more often than once a month. Did it go easy? No, it did not. But fortunately, there is a charter provision saying that decision on who will be invited to the Security Council session is the decision where you do not have a veto power. So you need 9 votes. 9 out of 15 to have that. And Yuriy, I do not know, were you still a Ukrainian ambassador when it was US presidency and I had to brief?
Yeah, I was. And we had twice when they voted to have you in the room or not. Yeah. Twice.
And Security Council had to start. And one country that the evening yesterday has supported my briefing has during the night suddenly changed its mind. And then, we were having Deputy Secretary General Jan Eliasson was also briefing. It was consent about him. There wasn't consent about me. And Security Council session was suspended for 2 hours. While two sides were telephoning, talking to heads of states and government in the middle of the night because of different hours all over the world, who will get 9 votes? Will there be 9 votes or will it be 8-7? At the end of the day, it was 9 votes at a time. But it's an illustration. It's sometimes an uphill battle. And sometimes composition of Security Council is decisive whether you have that 8 votes or 9 votes. At the moment, the situation is not very easy.
I do remember that. It was not easy and it was awful. Well, luckily we had you and we had this discussion. And another issue you raised, and it concerns the question that sometimes the Security Council needs to be presented with an issue well packed. I do remember that the Security Council rejected to listen any approach on the climate change as the challenge to the security. So only I worked with a delegation of Tuvalu, Vanuatu, and Kiribati, most affected, and advised them, don't bring your address started with climate change as challenging to something. Start with security. Start with security, and then we got the issue in the Security Council, then in General Assembly, and now they do understand that this is about the losing of human lives and the territories. States are disappearing. So it means that if to bring it as a security issue, and then it's much easier to find these nine votes, well, and to bring it inside. But again, there are at least two members on the permanent seats who reject any human rights issue to be in a council. Moving them, you have the Human Rights Council in Geneva, move there. It's not our problem. Well, sorry to keep you waiting.
I'd like to thank our speaker for his support of the NGO Committee on Human Rights at the UN, because I think something has been lost from going to non-governmental organizations from varying countries who could be committed to notions of democracy, of education, of peace, to something called civil society, which is not always civil to come up. And that at one point, when Eleanor Roosevelt spoke at Brandeis when I was a student, she pointed out that human rights begin at home. And my thesis advisor, who is one of the first social science directors of UNESCO, also looked at education and ways of beginning to look at countries within their own frames of reference in terms of disputes and dispute settlement, etc. Now that has become harder even in this country. But it does seem to me that you can't keep people in camps for years and years and years and not do what the UN did after World War II, which was to simply assign every country so many refugees. And I was curious if there are ways of beginning to look at some of the strengths within the member states prior to the outbreaks of this kind of violence that we are seeing, or the fear that's expressed in votes, in order to reconnect the local with the international. And I wondered if you had any thoughts about that in terms of the protection of human rights.
You know, you are raising a very important issue, and it's a challenge of solidarity in contemporary world. And we can see how European Commission's attempt to identify quotas based on some very rational scientific criteria for allocation of refugees in individual countries, how it was rejected by certain political leaders using it for their national, for raising their national and nationalist political support. We are seeing that with Paris Agreement on prevention of climate change. The same issue that you can be, if you observe it as an individual state, you can be a free rider, and if others are investing in protection of the climate, well, if you do not, you benefit out of the whole thing. But you do increasingly have some indirect sanctioning mechanisms. There was a threat coming from the United States that there might not be any attempts to contribute to prevention of climate change. And there was a reaction by some other states then saying, okay, then we shall impose a tax on all your products because you are not contributing. So I do believe that the way out of challenges we are facing is just to rationally admit that in interconnected world, global solidarity is the only rational choice, not only moral choice. It's the only rational choice. It's something that I met. I was in the United Nations chairing a working group on human rights while countering terrorism. And I met a lot of people working in intelligence services that were quite convinced that the use of torture, the use of arbitrary detention is absolutely necessary if you need to efficiently protect civilians. It simply is not the case. It has been empirically proven that people under torture, first of all, quite often invent lies that are then misleading for further political action. And secondly, this is something that I've seen when talking to both Afghan authorities and Taliban, that torture committed by Afghanistan government has significantly contributed to be able to recruit new members. Each torture victim has tens of relatives. At least some of them will want to go and to fight to revenge their martyr. It's the question again, the question when fighting Boko Haram or when fighting Al-Shabaab, I'm mentioning that because in those cases I personally have talked to civilians. It's quite clear that toughness to civilians, if they are suspected to have understanding or to support terrorists, that it backfires. So respect of human rights, not torturing, not targeting civilians, is not only a moral thing to do. It's most efficient thing to do. I mean, it's not only faraway countries. It's not only Boko Haram and Al-Shabaab. Let us remember Irish Republican Army. Beginning of Irish Republican Army was a small group of thugs putting bombs in pubs. And it was heavy-handed response by British authorities, by their security forces, which have created martyrs. And it transformed Irish Republican Army into a strong political group using sometimes also terror and violence, but with a sort of legitimacy among their own constituency. We can't allow that. Let's get back to your question. Solidarity and human rights are the key. Locally, regionally, and internationally.
Good.
Charles Mitchell, I'm a student here. I had two questions about Burundi. The first has to do with the relatively new process of quarterly review and senior action group. And how do you think it's performed in Burundi to date, where it's been successful and where it could be improved upon, as far as prevention and early warning? And then secondarily, you mentioned that it's important to communicate with the parties involved before the point of no return. What's in Burundi, what's the best way to do that? Is it, and does it involve regional or sub-regional organizations?
And you plan to visit Burundi soon?
Yeah, I do. I think I'll be in January in Burundi again. I think it may be surprising because hundreds of people have been killed. I think probably 1,000, around 1,000 in Burundi. I still think that in Burundi we had so far some successes in preventing full-blown escalation and mass atrocities. Burundi has a potential of mass atrocities, but when I'm saying mass, I'm not speaking only about thousands, I'm speaking about tens of thousands, I'm speaking of hundreds of thousands. So Burundi is a country that is right now on the brink, but somehow we managed to keep it on the brink. We managed to keep it on the brink, and I'll tell you what I think was highly important. It was highly important to have some internationals who were there, and to have some civil society and media that were also reporting on the situation. However, those resilience mechanisms are now falling apart. Civil society activists are either out of country, or dead, or underground. Media outlets closed. Internationals, whether they come from African Union or whether they come from United Nations, have much less opportunities to either monitor or to report. That makes me very worried. There was a period when we faced something very disturbing. It was a period when top-level officials started to use derogatory language addressing the other ethnic group, which, if we remember Rwanda, was one of early signs of mobilizing, using codes for preparation of mass atrocities. In Burundi, I am first of all concerned that in December something similar will happen as we have faced last December when there was that attack on army barracks. The early sign is, I think it happened yesterday or day before yesterday, when President's public PR, top PR official, who is brother of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, there was an assassination attempt. He was wounded, his bodyguard has been killed, and so on. So again, we are seeing high-profile targeted killings, which can be used by regime for large-scale retaliation. In Burundi, I think that we need to mobilize whoever we can to keep Burundi on a brink. On a brink means we are incapable of preventing some, not only human rights violation, but some crimes. We are saying that hundreds of people have been killed, but not yet hundreds of thousands. So I think that we should use all leverage we have, and one aspect of leverage is that over 50% of the state budget of Burundi comes from donations, should be used to keep it on the brink and prevent it from falling into ambis. When I was talking to the Security Council on Burundi, I said, do not wait in Burundi for numbers to be your red line, because Burundi, country with a history of genocide, country where things are under the carpet about inter-ethnic relations, if you wait for the high numbers of casualties to go for decisive action, it's a forest fire you won't be able to stop. It reaches point of no return. Use other red lines when you have to be completely mobilized. For me, I think, as far as I remember, I identified a couple of those red lines. One was the use of derogatory language targeting the opposite ethnic group. The other one was divisions in the security forces and sidelining officers belonging to some ethnic group from the operational duties. And I think that the third one was arming and training youth militias who could then be used potentially for mass atrocities. At the moment, all those three red lights are not fully blowing but are blinking.
Okay. Yes, please.
Your Excellency, it is heartwarming to know that the next Secretary General intends to prioritize prevention. But I also heard you when you said that you don't foresee any major changes in the UN Charter. So my question is, with principles such as sovereignty, territorial integrity, and the rest of them still enshrined in the Charter, how does he intend to surmount these charter provisions or challenges that we have in the charter? Thank you.
It's certainly a valid point. I think that in the United Nations, my involvement in the United Nations in different capacity has taught me that if you wait for a big change, if you wait for a big bang, it never happens. So in the United Nations, I believe in reforming by doing, and then at a later stage, when things have already changed, go for legislative changes. So I do think that there is some maneuvering space, that respecting charter, respecting sovereignty and sovereign equality of member states, more can be done in sense of prevention. In fact, I am considering in my new capacity of Special Advisor on Responsibility to Protect, open a discussion on the conditions of use of force under Chapter 3. Everybody says it's suicide. Countries are so divided. You can't do it. You will just end up hated by both camps, and the division between them will be deeper. This atmosphere has been especially created by intervention in Libya and its perception. As you may know, there was a UN Security Council mandate for intervention in Libya. However, there is a wide perception that military intervention did not go only for protection mandate, which was given by the Security Council, but for a regime change. And that ending in a chaos that we see in Libya is, for many countries now, a reason to say, never use of force, never use of force, and any use of force is damaging. What I would like is a rational dialogue. How to ensure that in situations when force is the only way to protect people from mass atrocities, force is used, but it is used responsibly. How to ensure accountability for the use of force. Accountability of the Security Council, not only for the use of force, for any coercive measures. Accountability for the use of sanctions. How to ensure that you have impartial and objective monitoring on the effects of sanctions? Are sanctions really affecting a government which is, for example, a great human rights violator, or are sanctions really undermining the life of common people? We are moving in that direction in the United Nations, smart sanctions, freezing of assets of some top-level people in foreign countries, travel bans. We are learning a bit how to use sanctions smarter, not just ban of imports and things like that. But we are still on an upwards curve of learning. In sense of sovereignty and responsibility to protect, I think that the logic should be, in fact, protection of sovereignty, but interpreting sovereignty as a responsibility. So sovereignty of a state is a responsibility to take care of people in its own territory. And if a country has a problem in exercising such a sovereignty, then it's obligation of other states to help financially with technical assistance, to help country to achieve protection of its own population. How can that technical assistance look like? It can be troops training, police training, trying to produce a ruler-binding, disciplined security forces. It can be strengthening of justice system, strengthening of independence of justice system, strengthening access to the justice system. There are ways that can help to the prevention of mass atrocities, respecting national sovereignty. And then, if at a certain point in time, international community, after the affirmative decision of Security Council, uses coercive powers, even uses military force, what needs to be clear is that that force is used in such a way that sovereignty of a country and its capability to take care of its own people and preventing of mass atrocities is reestablished as soon as possible. Was that done in Libya? No, it wasn't done in Libya. But we should keep in mind that our goal is to bring sovereignty as a responsibility to protect people back to the country as soon as possible.
Please.
I didn't hear. Who has a role?
Oh, it's the UN will have a role in any future intervention. Thank you.
Frankly, I'm ashamed to speak about Syria. I think that generations after us will not understand how we failed Syrian people. Simply will not understand. I mean, to have, we do not know how many, but about 300,000 people killed, and so many more of them not killed directly. We are counting killed by explosions and bullets. How many people died because of higher maternity death rate, the child mortality, how many people died of diseases because of lack of medicines, because of lack of safe drinking water and so on, we can only speculate about. You have half of a country needing humanitarian assistance. So I'm ashamed and I always think that all of us could and should have done more for Syria. The problem with Syria is that we have overlap of three circles of interests in Syria. Interests of global powers, influence of regional powers, and local divisions in Syria. And it's a vicious circle. And for me, it's morally unacceptable that some regional powers are fighting in Syria until the last of Syrian in a proxy wars. So if you ask me, will UN have the role? Yes, but after bleeding out of Syria. Syria is not dying in a one big dramatic battle, even such a huge battle as Aleppo, but it's bleeding out. Syria is bleeding out. At the end of those, that bloodletting, it's likely that it's going to be United Nations, you know, collecting the pieces. Now it seems that Assad has an upper hand and that he can end this thing militarily. I'm not convinced. It's just a temporary shift of military success, but it will continue as a guerrilla warfare, as terrorist acts. So I am pessimistic about Syria. I'm pessimistic. And again, we shall see whether there is a way to find not only compromise between United States and Russian Federation. What is essential is to deal with regional antagonisms between Saudi Arabia and Iran, and without resolving those issues, the issue of Syria will not be resolved.
Great. Thank you. If no questions, so we'll go to finalize. Thank you, first of all, Ivan, for accepting this invitation, and thank you the audience to come today and to speak. Yes, R2P, it is the global political commitment. People, they supported it during the World Summit in 2005. But still we are looking for the bigger consensus and bigger support. R2P needs more legitimacy in its operation, and so the world community, and we are part of the world community. We are to prove and support that, because we do understand, and today it was sounded here, and you know more, that a lot of the different gaps to be bridged, normative gaps, they spoke about the problems with the interpretation of charter. So Ukrainian case, when one of the country in before invading, they created artificial R2P to protect the Russian-speaking population, which is not in any list of, and then they immediately launched the humanitarian intervention. Of course, you said about that, and the audience confirmed that what is important to bridge and to fill the compliance gap when the states with their sovereignty, they are first to be responsible for any commitments they signed up under the United Nations Charter. So most probably this is the most challenging, to make the states to fulfill their major obligations before their own people. I do understand how many critics you are receiving, because R2P, this is about the protection of victims and the sovereignty. And I'm sorry, but sovereignty is on the second place. Victims are the first, and so I could imagine how much critics are coming from certain states that alleged the infringements in the of the sovereignty, interference in affairs. And so on behalf of all of our gathering, we wish you all the best in your new endeavors. Well, we are waiting you in February. You got this invitation for a broader meeting. So, and well, thank you again.
Thank you very much.